Welcome to the Deerfield Selectboard Board of Health meeting on September 21st, 2016, at 6:35 p.m. here in the municipal offices in the village of South Deerfield. First order of business is our cable franchise agreement.
You have at your right a copy of the cable franchise agreement.
Bill's not coming in,
Bill
right?
Will not be here tonight. I expect that he'll be here at the meeting on the 3rd of October, but he wanted to make sure that you had a copy of this so you could review it. If you'd like, I can print additional copies for you to review. Broadly speaking, this is the result of about 3.5 years of negotiation with our cable provider, Comcast. As you know, three towns, Whately, Sunderland, and Deerfield, coordinated efforts to negotiate with Comcast, and that way, instead of just having 1,900 or 2,000 subscribers in Deerfield versus Comcast, at least we had about 5,500 subscribers all told between the three towns. And that's a significant chunk of money for them every year.
Yeah.
That allowed us to make sure that cable is available at all streets, to make sure that there is at least a side letter which will allow for a senior discount for cable services. It allows for maintenance agreements to make sure that the cable network is being kept up. And it allowed for also the funding of the local access TV, which makes the television production of these meetings possible. This contract has been looked on very carefully by representatives from the local access TV, and it's been negotiated, I think, in Deerfield's favor, at least somewhat. I believe this is about as good of a contract as we can expect to get, unless we want to go into extended, protracted agreement or negotiation with Comcast. So my recommendation is try to take a look at it. Reach out to me if you have questions, but I think it's a pretty good agreement, and it's definitely worth endorsing. A modified version of this contract has been made available to Sunderland and Whately, as some minor numbers inside will have changed, but broadly speaking, they're agreeing to the same terms.
Actually voted yes?
They have not yet.
Okay.
No, they're going to be looking at this contract early in October as well.
Oh, okay. All right.
Have any other companies like Cox tried to get into town or?
No.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
The difficulty, because there's such a great infrastructure involved in providing a wired service like cable television, it's very likely that there wouldn't be any other vendor willing to make that much of an investment for what adds up to be $90 per subscriber. Wireless, like satellite, and other services like internet over DSL, these are the biggest competitors. It may very well be that this is going to be the last franchise agreement that the town signs because of changes in technology. But we'll see how it goes.
Yeah. Thank you.
In some ways, it's better to do it and
get it done. Yes.
And have it enforced, just because we might end up with nothing pretty soon.
This will provide support to the town. It provides the town with a lever in case something's going wrong. It gives us a lever with which to pry Comcast loose on certain issues. And it does continue to provide support for the local access TV, which is continuing to grow and it's continuing to succeed. It continues to be a resource for students. There's a great deal of interaction between Frontier Community TV and Frontier Regional School. And we see a lot of kids that are migrating from the school to the Access Center, looking for additional training, looking for participation on projects. And that, I think, is a great option.
I don't really understand all the technology, but the technology trends are that cable will be obsolete. Should we be writing a letter to the governor saying you need to give us some kind of tax on the new technology that will replace as a funding source our cables?
I think
income?
It would be great if you'd
because
like to...
Because otherwise we have nothing for our cable local access.
Yep. I think it would be great if you write a letter actually to the state and to our representatives encouraging them to support and protect the local negotiating rights of towns and cities. This franchise is just for Deerfield. Every other town or city that has cable TV has the option to create a franchise agreement like that and to negotiate for what terms
But I was more concerned of the technology change as well.
Right.
So would you be able to do that? Is that all right with you guys?
Fine.
Yeah.
Before you leave, Doug.
Oh, absolutely.
Since you understand this, could you just gin up a letter that I could sign?
I think also a letter going to the federal government actually makes sense, specifically to the FCC.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything is moving to a digital medium, regardless of whether it's being delivered by wires or through the air, That's the next stage of media delivery, and that's the next area where a community buy-in or a community public service fee should be charged.
I just want to put it on record and then put it in a tickler somewhere so that we're constantly sort of following up on it. But if you gin up, since you understand all this, could you gin up the letter?
Absolutely.
Addressing the fact that as a funding source, this is going to go away eventually, actually pretty soon, and we need to find some way to keep our local access funded, you know, our FCAP funded somehow.
Okay.
So thank you. I'd appreciate that.
Sure.
Next item on the agenda is our announcements. I just want to say there was some West Nile virus mosquitoes detected in Montague, but here in Deerfield we're still testing negative. So people just need to be careful. We've had dry weather, although we did have some rain, so you know you'll see the upkick in mosquitoes this next week. So just do what you responsibly should be doing, which is beware of peak activity time like dusk to dawn for mosquitoes. Use insect repellent if you're out. Patrol your yard for standing water. Just the stuff that we've been talking about all year long. I mean, there's been no Triple E, which is just fantastic. It's been too dry for Triple E, and that is really what is scary, and that has not occurred so far. So I really it's just West Nile, which young children and elders and autoimpaired people, immune-impaired people should be aware of. So anything you can do just to protect yourself, patrol your yard, that's the most responsible thing. And school's already started. First preschool cold already is I've gotten. So keep washing your hands.
Yeah.
And if you get coughed on, there's not much you can do. But if you wash your hands and wipe down all your surfaces, phones, door handles, that's still the most and the best way, cheapest way to protect yourself, even though I don't know what the heck happened. I had four kids, and you would think I would have have a lot of immunity, but here we go.
Yep.
So anyway, so it's just from a Board of Health point of view, watch out for mosquitoes and wash those hands.
Yep.
And I do want to say, this is Doug's last select board meeting, and we're going to miss you. And
very much.
Good luck. Executive Director of the Martha Vineyard Chamber Music Society. I mean, I think it's
You did pretty good on that. It's a real mouthful. Yeah, thank you.
I think it's so exciting that you're going to be moving down there with your wife and starting a new adventure. And we're going to miss you, Doug.
I miss you tremendously.
I think we're getting. I'm getting a little panicky that
moving
on.
Oh yeah.
We're going to have an empty office, but thank you, Doug. For everything that you've been doing and working very hard right up till the dear end here. I really appreciate it.
Yep. Thank you very much.
You've been very good and very committed to us, and I want you to know I really appreciate that, especially.
Yep. Very much.
Did either one of you have other announcements?
I'm trying to think. I think Doug got us on the cleanup for Deerfield. The Deerfield River down by Stillwater Bridge,
which was a
mess for trash.
Yep.
So in the river cleanup, we've got on that date, which is Saturday, I believe.
I think it's
this coming Saturday.
Yeah,
Friday and Saturday, yeah.
Or 24th, yeah.
Yeah.
So oh, yeah.
23rd, 24th. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep.
So that's really
river
great.
River cleanup. Yes.
Yep.
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 Anybody
Friday,
that wants
Saturday.
To volunteer.
Yes, please. Anybody that wants to help come out and help clean up.
There is a link on the town's website for anyone who wants to sign up to support the source to stream cleanup. And that's for tributaries and the Connecticut River itself, all the way up and down the banks of the river. And you can specifically sign up to support the Deerfield cleanup along Stillwater Bridge and in that area. So I encourage folks to check the website if they want to sign up.
Just be very careful. There's a tremendous amount of poison ivy along the riverbanks. So if you don't know what it looks like, please find someone that can point out poison ivy. Okay.
Have we heard anything
the
more
three,
from
let it be.
The bakery people?
That's one of the things we're going to be talking about on executive session.
Okay.
Yep.
With the rainfall that we just had, the mosquitoes that have been laying dormant, will be out for next weekend.
Yes.
So make sure you people bring mosquito repellent or long sleeve shirts and things of that nature, because we got a very dry year, which has been
great.
God said we'd take some mosquitoes, but the lava can sit up to 6 to 8 weeks.
Wow.
And all it needs is the water for it to germinate. And basically, it looks like it's going to be the perfect storm for this coming weekend.
Yeah, when people are by the river cleaning up, right?
Yeah.
That's
good. Please use lots of insect repellent. Mark is absolutely right. The cycle, the cleanup will be happening this weekend, which is when you'll have the next cycle of mosquitoes.
It comes from that rain we got.
Yeah.
We haven't had much rain.
It's perfect, so anybody's coming out.
Great. Thank
it's
you, Mark.
It's absolutely true. Thank you, Mark, for bringing that up. Again, please just be really prudent. Like I said, the West Nile is circulating around. It's in East Hampton. It's in Northampton. But it isn't here in Deerfield yet that we're aware of. But that doesn't mean that it isn't. It's just we haven't trapped any mosquitoes, for sure. So. Minutes. We have amended August 10th. September 7th and September 14th. Were you all able to review those?
Yep, I was able to read them.
I did not. Okay. Would you like a couple minutes? Because they're right here. They're not very long.
I would like to just mention that the August 10 minutes were previously approved. Since that time, there was an omission that was discovered. The board did approve a revised letter of support or no opposition to patient network.
Yep.
There was a slight revision to that letter that was approved on that night, and the notation of that was left out of the minutes. So I wanted to make sure that we were doing things right and brought the minutes before you again was revised.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you, Doug.
That omission,
no, that's fine.
Record is clean.
Yep. No, that's it.
Just a question on. It was, I had a question on support to the superintendent. Oh, I was, change of hours. I was wondering what that was, change of hours for board requested that the superintendent be invited to meet. I got all that. But then Finn requested approval of the change of hours request, maybe for time, but it was submitted by Viasam LLC?
Yes, change of hours request. I'm not sure if that, did that come before
that
you? That may be
it said
something
we voted
that corrected.
3-0 on it, and I just wasn't, I didn't remember it. Probably...
That was, I think that was the license change request, right?
Correct. It's a formality
that
has to happen when a liquor license comes before.
That's what it was, yep. It was grouped in this one here, and I wasn't sure what it meant. So that makes sense. I do remember now. Thank you.
Viasam is the parent company that operates the neighbors up on Route 116.
Got it.
They basically added or asked for a requested change of hours.
A little early on Sunday, yep.
Yeah, yeah. And you guys approved it. It just gets sent to the ABCC. It's just performed.
Okay, good. Thank you very much.
Thank you for bringing that up, though. A lot of the packet, and I apologize for it, is the handout that was given at the recent presentation by Terry Williams.
Which I found.
But there was a great deal of information in there that was beneficial, and I thought it made sense.
Yes.
And I thought the presentation was great.
It was.
I'm really glad for the attendance at that.
It was good overview.
Yeah, definitely good review.
Yep. Helpful for us new folks.
Yeah. If you guys are okay with them, we can do it.
I'm good.
All three at once.
You also have immediately following as part of the consent agenda is the approval of the payroll and accounts payable warrants. And if you just move approval of the consent agenda, you hit them all with one fly swatter.
Got it.
Okay.
Then.
The minutes from the 14th.
You don't have the minutes from the 14th?
I don't think so.
The 14th, this is the 14th, I think so.
The 14th is the minutes from the
Finance Committee presentation.
Oh, that was a presentation, yep.
It's just a side page.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Well, I would...
I'm good with that.
You're good? I would make a motion to approve the consent agenda, which would consist of minutes amended for August 10th, September 7th, September 14th, and payroll and warrants.
I'll second it.
Is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, okay. Discussion items, the first is the RFP on the snow removal services, award the contract. It should be right here. I'll entertain a motion.
Just follow that real quick here.
Do you want the total, Doug? Do we have, actually, we don't have
a total. We don't have a total, right? It was just per hour?
It is just an hourly rate, yes.
Yeah.
And it's for the next 3 years?
It is a one-year term.
Okay.
It may be renewed at the town's sole option for an additional 2 one-year terms. So it's good for up to 3 years.
Okay.
But the terms for FY 2017 are what applies this year. If you renew, then of course the terms for FY 2018 apply and so on and so forth.
And due to fuel, this was less than we had last time?
That's our guess.
Yep.
The bottom line is that the proposed prices did come under, come below what was originally, what we would have expected, so.
Everything's in order as far as the
yes,
those data. I make a motion to approve the snowplow bid, IFB 2007-15 to Gilmore Construction of Deerfield, Mass.
I second that motion.
Discussion?
Is there any discussion?
Well, I still think that the town could do this themselves and save us quite a bit of money. We currently have 11 snow plowing pieces of equipment and 6 employees, and we're about to get a 12th piece of equipment. I think that it would be in the best interest of the town to hire a per diem plow driver and just put a couple of our trucks that are there anyways and do this.
I did ask Kevin, and he said it would negatively impact what the routes we already have scheduled, and he did not have the ability to do this.
Well, you know, if you want to pay someone $90 an hour versus $20 an hour, that's up to you. I just don't think it's a good idea, but that's only one of three.
Well, it's equipment and operator, so that's why it's...
We already have the equipment.
So Kevin felt that he wouldn't have the equipment.
Kevin felt that this was essential for operating and clearing the roads. You can follow up on it if you would like, but
I'd like to just suggest that the idea is certainly has merit to see what the town could do internally. And I would certainly encourage you, the board, to pursue that, particularly as you start to develop the budget for FY18.
Right.
The advantage to this is that this is a one-year contract.
Right.
With the option to renew next year if you want to. If a way to do the work internally and save money it can get formulated, then I say fantastic, great. If we can get the job done and save money, that's perfect. And you're absolutely right. There's a lot of gear at the highway garage.
Right.
The staffing has always been the issue.
And we're down one person already.
Right now, yeah, we're down one person. That's, if anybody out there wants a job, please submit an application.
Well,
we've received two applications only.
My thinking is that, you know, we might have a difficult time finding a full-time operator. But there's a large number of, you know, truck drivers, construction people who are usually laid off in the wintertime.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's an abundance of people to do that at that time, you know.
To hire per diem, like you said.
Now, yes, you know, there could be an early snow or late snow where, you know,
they're
these companies
working.
Are out there, but for the vast majority of them, you know, they're they're unemployed and...
Kim, I have no problem if we...
We should look into that then.
Talk to Kevin further, but I did, in fact, ask him about this, and he said it would negatively impact.
So
he couldn't do it.
We could approve for this year and then look into this for the following years and see what's going on.
There's no reason not to have further conversation with Kevin.
Right.
But I did specifically ask him.
Okay.
Could we do this? And in his professional estimation, that we could not.
Okay. Well.
So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye.
Okay. 2-1, Doug.
Thank you.
We have a resignation from the Cultural Council. Now,
okay.
I'm really sorry.
I know.
If there's anyone
that.
Else interested, Lou Vincent said he was just unable to do it. And I thank him.
He's a wonderful person.
Yeah, I really thank him for his time. And if there's anyone else interested, I would hope that they would come forward.
This
it's
was
Lou Vincent.
Lou Vincent. She was on the Cultural Council.
And so if there's anyone else interested, please come forward. Yep.
Currently, the Cultural Council has 5 regular members. That's mandated by the state. But there are a number of alternate members which allow the Cultural Council to continue to operate regardless of whether or not people can make meetings. Lou was one of 5 alternate members, so that still leaves 4 alternates plus the 5 full-time members. But I do know that the folks on the Cultural Council are certainly welcoming any additional participation.
It's energy and excitement and ideas.
Vision, ideas.
Absolutely.
Creativity. So please, if anyone's interested, please come. And thank you very much. Just want to make sure.
Yeah, she was.
She's really appreciative.
Yep.
We have appointments, a request from South County EMS, some more pre-jam persons.
Just a question. So these are just people that they would hire to fill a schedule as they needed. We're not
part-time
hiring them.
No.
Okay.
We have to appoint them so that
they're available to be hired.
Right. To fill in.
To fill in.
They have to be still appointed whether they're full-time or just
fill
one
in.
Shift a month.
Okay.
By appointing them, it basically covers them under our insurance.
I see.
It makes their participation with a town official.
Legal. So. Okay.
If Zach's not here, do we know if some of these per diem people will ease the labor force so there'll be less overtime with some of the regular people?
I think that's the
people?
Idea.
It's the idea, but in these 2 cases, they won't, because these are people who...
These are basics.
They're EMT basics, and they have yet to receive their EMT certification. They're essentially fresh out of high school.
Okay.
They've expressed an interest in becoming a paramedic, and they'll be participating, but they're going to be participating as almost like a third member of the crew at this point.
Learning.
That's my understanding. More detail can be provided by... They can be the second?
They can be the drivers.
They can be the driver or...
Yeah. I see.
A second person on a crew, sure.
Crew,
okay.
So
yeah.
Just being per diem, they won't be in the schedule until they meet all of their ride-along time. But as a basic, it's not that long.
Okay.
Are you aware as to whether or not a person doing ride-alongs is being paid to do that?
Yes, they are.
So they're getting paid at... The basic rate, $13.62, the basic EMT rate.
Because they are.
Yeah.
In these days, having 2 people is the minimum limit.
Sure. Right.
Having a third set of hands is a godsend on a lot of these cases where you have to deal with both, you know, a family situation, family members, some of the larger people. You know, this
multiple.
Runs in, and that's where the police have always been extremely helpful because they've always been that extra. This allows the policeman to go out and do the job that they are really supposed to be handling. So it's not for naught, but it's just a short period of time for the EMT to
gain their experience.
To actually be paid and do the second position.
Yep.
It's the paramedic that has to do the
hours and hours of run-on is required by state law that costs us the big bucks to get them to that level, but that was something that we've grown into.
Great.
So I think we've done very well. Mm. And we need to keep a crew of kids, people coming up through the ranks so that we, because we've lost one of our full-time paramedics.
Yeah.
To a full-time gig somewhere else in a bigger state. So they're always looking to move up, and Deerfield's a great training ground.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you.
It's just always nice to have younger.
Pardon?
It's nice to have the younger
yes.
community members that want to participate.
Yeah, as energetic as they are, coming out of the EMT classes, they're just a wealth of fresh air.
Yeah.
So to speak. They're a nice group of people to work with.
Great. Jeff?
Just a quick comment, or actually a couple. One, I think, obviously, they're doing an excellent job providing the service. A concern that I do have, though, when we're talking about personnel here, are we paying for their training? And if we are paying for their training, is there a commitment of a number of years that they have to stay with the service before they can move on? Because if we're paying for training, and once they, at some point in time, just move on, without that commitment to, my understanding is that training is fairly expensive. Are we kind of throwing money away?
It's a good question.
That would be my only concern. Mm. As I said, I want to make sure everybody understands. I think the service that they've been providing has been excellent.
Yeah.
Actually, Jeff, I don't know what the commitment requirement is, so that's a good question. We can ask that tomorrow night at our meeting tomorrow night. We can ask if there's any kind of commitment required. I know if we pay for or sponsor people for the police department in police academy, it's a 3-year commitment.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, but I don't know. That's a good question.
We'll take a look tomorrow.
We'll ask that tomorrow.
With full-time employees versus a per diem employee, the requirements are slightly different. Even in the police department, there's no training that would be provided. The person is expected to come with a set of skills if they're working just as a per diem. With a full-time employee, then possibly an arrangement for training could be made.
Mm-hmm.
But
and the difference is paramedic goes through their schooling on their dock.
Whereas
when we send a policeman to the academy, we're sending them to a location and they're not here getting trained. The paramedics and the EMTs that we're talking about training are on our rigs, giving
that field
support and knowledge and skill of what they're to do for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not it's not the formal aspect of the training, but the actual practical training for us. And if you, as Doug said, if we hired somebody on to be this and sent them through paramedic school, then we would want the same type of contract.
Yeah.
Because it's not now a 40-week class or whatever class. And in the case where we sponsor them, we pay for travel, their hours worked, everything else. So we're asking for them to pay us back for us paying for this. A paramedic doesn't go to school where we pay them to go drive to school, we don't pay for their classes, we don't pay for, we do after they start working for us, we pay for some of the required training that happens because we do it on the job time.
Right.
And some of them are required by us or the state. Without it, we don't have them.
Right.
It's no different than a police officer having their 24 hours of training that we have to pay for, whether it's firearms or first aid training or whatever it is, they're here getting paid for that.
Do you know how long they would do the ride-alongs and stuff before they become an EMT? I'm just curious, police, like you said.
They're different for each level.
Oh, okay.
The basic is a minimal, approximately 10 to 20 hours.
I see.
And when you get up to the paramedic, it's so many hours, but it's also you have to do something specific, whether it's put a tube down, whether you have to have
someone. I was going to say innovation. I know one of the things is innovation.
Until you have somebody have that need,
yep,
you never get signed off.
Right,
so
right.
And they could do the same thing. They'll go into a hospital and work on the emergency room to get that signature.
Right.
And they're working as a EMT or something on shift.
Yeah.
But it's to their best interest to get all those signatures signed off.
Sure.
And I may be a little dated. I haven't kept up with.
Yep.
That's right. And I don't want to quote hours.
No, that's fine. I'm just curious.
You know, I did it for 30 years, but it's been almost 10.
Right.
That I haven't done it. It's kind of became a.
Things change.
Yeah.
Yep.
Things change a lot.
Bad.
But I've listened to the people and watched, and we talk about it, but not the detail of the exact number of hours.
Yep. Thank you.
One of the things, Linda Moriarty did a lot of our paperwork for the Western Mass EMS, and she passed away. So is that going to have an impact on us?
Linda was one of the most dynamic people you'll ever want.
I know.
She took everything very...
Well, she helped us a lot.
Yeah,
and
she had the marching order. She actually marched us the way we needed to do. She's trained some really good people.
Yeah.
But I don't think you'll ever find anybody that will fill the shoes of her.
No, she did. She did an extra lot. She was on a lot of committees with me.
We may lose that. I don't want to call it a strong enough.
Yeah.
But she had a grasp of how to tell people what was needed and how to get it to be accomplished. Very dynamic person.
It was great to read her obituary. I didn't know her, but just to see the what she had done for people in the state and all the different boards and stuff she had been on to help people, it's just amazing.
She's an outstanding person. I mean, that type of functionality and stick-to-itiveness.
Yeah.
She marched us in many directions. I'd have to say she's probably one of the leading reasons we are where we are today in Western Mass.
That's great. Yep.
And we led because of her. We led a lot of the changes that happened in the Cape and happened in other places. So.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
So why don't you...
So I make a motion to approve the appointments for per diem. I might not do these names very well, but Zachary Bastioni, Mason Jenkins, and Yvonne M. Marino. To their to the EMT basic per diem.
I'll second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a request for regional housing coordinator. Asked Doug to put that on there, but I honestly felt that I didn't want any of us to fund that.
Right.
I felt that we were able to advocate for ourselves on a volunteer basis better, and that our money should go to a real project, not to a funding a person. Because
right.
Guess what?
Yep. No, I agree.
That could be a lot
of
money.
This is the FR COG.
Through the COG?
Yep.
For a regional housing coordinator.
Position, yeah.
So they could monitor subsidized units. Which we have none, provide assistance to residents facing foreclosure and seniors and develop RFPs. I mean, we're doing this. We need to fight for our own and
put the money to actual work.
To actual work. That's right. I just don't want to be bleeding money for nothing. We've been doing that already.
I'm actually really happy that you concluded that. Because that was actually my first knee-jerk reaction. I wasn't sure if I was being xenophobic or not, but the amount of money that Deerfield has to spend on projects like this is so small.
Right.
And to just take all of that and give it to the regional entity, well-intentioned.
You could soak up, sure. Yeah, you could soak up all our money.
You're paying for a small portion of that person's salary, and that person's going to spend all of their time working on a housing arrangement for Greenfield or Montague or Shelburne or Miller's or Irving, and Deerfield would never get anything out of it.
Or possibly Deerfield.
The only way that I can see that this would make sense is if the state took the low-income housing as a region into consideration, then it would make sense to support a regional effort to, what was that, a fly?
Yes, sorry, trying to get them all night.
Yeah. Then it would make sense for the towns to support a regional effort to provide planning and structure for these types of developments. But since every town is on their own when it comes to accounting for low-income housing, then every town needs to be on their own. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It'd be nice if you included that segment in your response back to FERPOP.
I'm happy.
Basically, we get nothing more out of this if they can convince the state to take us as a region where we get the same credits that everybody else gets. It would be great to embark on that, but we'd be paying for something we'd never be able to embark on.
Right.
It would be a zero net dollar loss to us.
And why isn't that being covered by our assessment already?
Yeah, true.
I mean, that's the way I look at it.
True.
Excuse me. Next item on the agenda is Dick's response to the Drozel property on Fair Street.
That's just included as a matter of information. I don't believe there's any action required on your part, but it's just to kind of put a button on that.
Was there anybody that had questions on that in the audience? I don't know if anybody was here.
Okay. Nope, I'm good with that.
He did check it out.
He looked at it. We have no jurisdiction. No enforceable violation. Okay.
You can't keep people. You can't force people to cut the grass.
Not just move it like to.
There is no violation.
Right.
Okay. Sorry. Next item on the agenda is site visit to Sugarloaf Street subdivision.
This is, again, just a reminder that the planning board is going to be making that visit.
Monday?
I believe on Monday.
Monday, 5:30.
5:30. This will not be a public meeting. It is not required to be a public meeting. But as such, you'll need to make sure you don't deliberate on anything.
Right.
You can certainly ask questions of the developer or anybody making the presentation. But you can't talk amongst yourselves, so to speak, or make any decisions. In that way, and the planning board will be doing the same thing and abiding by those same rules as well. So this will not be a public meeting per se, but you are more than welcome to attend as members of the Board of Health.
Did you have any update on this that you wanted to share with us?
No, not okay. Really at this time. I'm going to go.
Go take a walk through.
Anyways, just to see where it is. Yep.
My major concern, just of course from a public safety point of view, is the traffic.
Yeah.
You know, onto Sugarloaf. It's kind of a, I mean, that area is kind of busy.
It is.
And
it
so, is. I'd be interested from traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And then.
Water.
Water. Water is a huge concern.
Basements.
And if, I know, I mean, we don't have any bylaw that says no longer detention, retention ponds, but I really would just like to stress that from a public health point of view, we do not want detention and retention ponds.
Right.
Well, because that
mosquito
breeds infested. Mosquitoes.
That whole thing is kind of a funny area because in our bylaws in subdivision control, that's what it mandates. That's what we did at the highway garage, and we've been doing it for a long time. And, mm-hmm. and I've been an outspoken critic of that for a long time because really all they are is breeding grounds for mosquitoes.
Right.
And there are other, you know, I think other
well, it's,
better
it's
ways
very,
of dealing with that.
I was just going to say, you can plant a lot of native varieties of stuff that, you know, act, that would suck up water. You know, a rain garden kind of thing. I know when you say rain garden, people go roll their eyes. But you know, you plant Joe Pye weed, you plant, you know.
Stuff that takes a lot of water.
Sucks up water. And you effectively are removing the water without having it sitting there. So I just want you to keep that in mind when you're...
Yeah, I will.
Because, I mean, we just need to be smarter about that. Okay. So anyway, you will update us after that visit?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to go for both. You know, I guess as the Board of Health, too, you know, I mean, I already have some, I don't want to say ideas, but, you know... as far as dealing with the sewer in that area and stuff mm-hmm. like that, I mean, one of the issues with our, the problems at our current sewer plant is that there's not enough water flow. So this could be actually helping that aspect of it.
True.
You know, that's just one other thing that I'm going to look at.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying if stormwater
were diverted into the regular municipal sewers.
Oh, no.
You can't do that.
No, I meant that, you know, this whole subdivision as a whole, you know, just saying that if you add X amount of, you know, bathrooms in there, the flow is going to be greater through there. That could help that problem. But, you know, as from the planning board's point of view, as I've been reviewing our bylaws, we have a section of the bylaw that says it talks about conservation subdivision, and that's really all that it talks about in that area. And yet it has language that says you can have 50% fewer feet for frontage and 50% fewer square feet for lot sizes. But then it also says you can only have one dwelling unit per lot. So in the proposed development, it has 36 lots, which are bigger than they actually need to be.
Mm-hmm.
But it also calls for two family homes, which are not allowed by that, but they are allowed in the Central Village District. So once again, our bylaws are clashing, and you know, it's going to be up to the applicant to figure out which way he wants this project to go forward. I've tried and tried as a planning board member to adjust our bylaws, and I've had no success. But this is one of the things that it comes back. These types of things come back to haunt this town repeatedly. You know,
if we don't
address. Sometimes people might not like to make a rule that says you can do this, but not doing that creates other problems. You know, you know, and that's the scary part about going and not having good rules, because the thing that the town has been the most fearful of is having this 40B housing mm-hmm. coming in. But that's exactly what's going to happen, because there is no defined rules of what you can and can't do. And I know there are people on the planning board that would disagree with that, but if you read it, it's in black and white. And this project that's proposed for Sugarloaf Street calls for two family houses, but it goes against our bylaw, or part of our bylaw.
Yeah.
So it's going
to
be an interesting conversation, to say the least.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe it could be sorted out. I mean, we are having bylaw fixes
right.
in our next town meeting.
Do they have to generate in the planning board?
So
yes.
Yeah, and to fix the zoning bylaw of the town of Deerfield is a multi-year project.
Yeah, it is.
And really would require the services of a specialized consultant, because you almost need to be an attorney well-versed in, is it MGL Chapter 40A, which is the subdivision control bylaw. And you have to not only be well-versed in what exists, but also well-versed in the changes to that are coming. And then to be able to take that and use to have the bylaws of the town overlaid against that to see what works, what doesn't, what gets overridden.
Well, though, why don't we have see what it would cost to have Mark Bobrowski to review our subdivision laws? Because that's our firm, and he's the best.
Sure.
He's the best one in the entire state.
Sure.
I mean, he's written the book.
Is that right?
On land use, yes.
He literally has written the book, on zoning. To have him review the bylaws
just
and
see
provide
if get
recommended
a quote.
Changes?
Yes. See what it would cost to have him review some of our bylaws.
What I've tried to do, and I still think is probably one of the better ways to deal with in a town, is it kind of reminds me of like the health care. You know, if you try to reform all of our bylaws at once, it's going to be a disaster. People aren't going to understand it. This,
mm-hmm.
When you find a specific problem, I think that's the way to address it. See what the problem is and just change it. But don't just change it here. You have to look through all of the bylaws.
I was just going to say the problem
is what are the
is,
ramifications
what,
of
what
changing
other
this?
What things have you changed that
exactly.
are impacted?
It's like the stormwater bylaw thing. We have a form that's set up, and it's whether it's by accident or purpose, there's no way out of it. There's a whole guideline of if you answer yes to this, then proceed. Answer this, proceed. And it's to determine whether or not you need to go through this process. Well, if you read that, you can't avoid it. There's no way out of it. You know, it's a trap. And
yeah,
I tried to get.
But everybody has stormwater, though, and stormwater. If you don't retain it on site, it does impact your neighbors. That is important.
With larger development, you're absolutely right. If you're talking about large impervious areas like roofs or pavement or roadways, you're absolutely right. with
even an A&R, you still have to have. I mean, you still have. We have several homes in town that driveways run off into the roads and cause road hazards. Those driveways should never have been approved the way they are.
You're absolutely right.
And
absolutely right.
So
that's covered by a different part of the.
I know,
well,
but I'm just
where,
saying
that's
that
what
stormwater.
Saying, where one thing. You change one thing here, it's like pulling a thread and suddenly six
right.
other threads come
right.
out.
I mean, stormwater, yeah. water, I'm yeah. sorry, water in the town of Deerfield is an issue, no
absolutely.
Matter where you go.
Always has been.
And
been
it has to be, we have to look at that, Kip.
And I understand that, but mm-hmm. you many years ago, when people weren't quite as educated as we are, they figured out, you know, drains, pipes, brooks, they all served a real function. All of a sudden, now we're so smart, we can't do that. We got to keep it here. Well, you can't. You know, and I own a piece of property on Route 5 that's a prime example. If I want to put up a building, now I have to deal with 20,000 gallons of rainwater if you get 1 inch rain. But yet, I have a 24-inch culvert that puts 1.6 million gallons a day through my property.
Wow.
Am I supposed to be responsible for that? Mm. And, you know, and that's what I'm saying. You know, I didn't put the pipe under the railroad, but there it is. And there's a huge mountain behind it, and it all comes right down through my property. So according to our stormwater bylaws, I have to contain that? Well, even if I put an 8-foot concrete wall around my property, it would take about 6.5 hours and it would be going over this 8-foot wall. You know, and we laugh about it, but this is the reality of it. And it's like, do you guys ever think about this? And it's, you know.
So it's time to rethink.
The problem is it's not a small project.
Sure.
Well, it does require actually a paradigm shift. It requires a lot of people to come together and to create consensus about what it means to manage our rainwater and our water resources. There have been
and taking consideration new DEP regulations.
Mm-hmm. DEP regulations, new regulations related to water pollution control, and changes in and I know it sounds all green of me, changes in climate. Changes mm-hmm. in storms and all
we have
of that.
Extreme events, droughts,
and
then
spring and a summer with almost no rain, and then we had 4 inches of rain.
Well, but
you know, in the past 3 days.
In so. My box, this morning, or yesterday, there was something. I don't know. You must have got it. Something to do with post Irene, and there was some language in there that says Irene created the most devastation to farmland in Deerfield in history. Well, that's inaccurate, because the storm of 38 did. I mean, the storm of 38, you know, changed that whole area down there,
sure.
you know, and
sure.
it wiped out bridges from, you know, yeah. Canada or, you know, I don't know, it wiped
Bellows
out a lot
Falls,
of areas. Yeah,
down through
you know,
Connecticut.
It really did.
Yeah.
I have a photograph yeah. of Mount Toby without a tree on it.
Wow.
Because the year after that, you know, my grandfather was one of 300 loggers companies that they cut down all those dead trees and everything, and that whole mountain was barren. It was not just that one. I just happened to have a photograph of that. And, you know, you look at today, you'd never realize that.
Mm.
Well. But anyways.
So, Monday the 26th. Definitely.
Yes. Yep. You digress.
Yeah.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is some information that Doug had of the accessibility training. Is Kevin going to go to that? Did you forward that to Kevin?
He does have a copy of that. I am not sure if he's going to be attending it. There's actually a couple of different training opportunities in October that I'm hoping that Kevin will have an opportunity to attend, at least one or two of them.
Okay.
It's very difficult in some of these cases because, for example, the accessibility training is all day on the 25th and 26th, which I think is a Thursday and a Friday.
Mm.
So it gets tough to get
is that
away.
Just an ADA
It is, yes.
Sort of like sidewalks.
Yeah.
How do you do sidewalks?
Oh, is it Tuesday, Wednesday?
Yeah.
Oh, all this stuff, public access stuff.
Yeah. I wonder how high it takes. I mean, it's a pretty standard thing, you know, the minimum pitch that you can have and handrails and stuff like that. It's it's not really a complex thing. I don't know why it would take all day, but
right.
leave it to
yeah, but then if you go, yeah. you get certified. How many days is? I mean, how many years are you certified? You have to.
I am not sure.
You have to go like.
Really?
I mean, it's a required thing.
Is it?
To be a to do it, you have to go on enough. You have to get the hours. You just can't be an ADA
yeah.
coordinator. You have to actually go and get certified.
Get trained.
And then it's good for...
Is that usually the highway superintendent that does it, or...
In our town, it has been. But if you're volunteering to do it, I bet somebody would be glad to pass it on.
I didn't know if it would, it's just the building inspector or the board of health.
Dick does ADA some through his building commissioner, right? To get his building commissioner thing, he has to have X number of hours.
Yep.
But I think this is to be the actual ADA, to get the hours for the ADA coordinator that is required by the state. We have to have someone that is certified to do it. It doesn't have to be a town employee. It can be somebody that's volunteering.
Sure.
I mean, somebody that's interested could volunteer.
The advantage to...
And then who is then our coordinator? I mean, you get a stipend of $250 if somebody wants to do it.
Oh, I'm there.
But if they're, you know...
It's a long way from Martha's Vineyard.
If they have an interest in this field, and, you know, it might be a good opportunity.
I mean, if people are interested in... there's a lot of things we could try to... Once you get certified, then as a certified person, you can, you know, do programs and have us participate in programs. I mean, a lot can be done if someone is interested.
If we have someone dedicated to do it, it doesn't have another...
Just make sure Kevin knows. So in case in case the certification is up.
The the training is pretty extensive and actually is well-suited for someone who's going to be dealing with facilities because it covers things like construction or alteration of existing facilities. It will provide training on how to survey a facility to determine that it's meeting the ADA codes and examples of good and bad accessibility, places where technically you meet the code, but really there's a better way to consider providing true accessibility. I'll make sure that Kevin is aware of this and if he can attend.
When is that?
It's the 25th and 26th, a Tuesday and Wednesday. It is
all day. Of October.
And it's in at the Central Library in Chicopee. There's an $85 fee, which covers lunch on both days. It's an expensive lunch.
Good one.
And it will be a scent-free event. Please, no perfume, aftershave, or cologne. I'm just reading from the brochure.
I know, that's what it says. It is a scent-free event.
A scent-free event.
No,
you know, I'm actually never...
Event.
Sorry.
I never...
Nope. Well, it depends on what scent you're talking about.
You've also got in your information a memo from Kim McPhee at the FRCOG. This may be the thing that you were talking about, Kip. It's an upcoming presentation by the USGS. It's in regard to flood inundation mapping done in cooperation with FEMA Region 1. That's next week, Thursday. It's at 10 a.m., and I believe it's just 2 or 3 hours.
I'm actually going.
Oh, you are going?
Yeah,
oh, great.
Because, I've been trying to get TransCanada to do our mapping remap because our riparian buffers have really changed, and we're in some places 16 feet below where we were pre-Irene.
Wow.
So a much lesser event. Yeah. We would, you know, our roads, like Mill Village, would be inundated in a much lesser event. That berm that was put in 1938 from the 1938 hurricane
gone.
Was blown out
gone.
In Irene. So, and that's one of the places that is significantly lower.
Where is that?
It was actually that little piece that Doug brought up to sell, and I told him that you couldn't sell it.
Oh, yes. It's a very tiny little odd-shaped piece that actually is
it's pretty much
in the flood floodplain. But as you mentioned,
where the berm is
every spring. It's a buffer zone. So
it's where the berm was, and it it was. I think the reason why we ended up with it. We could trace it back, but I'm sure that the reason why the town ended up owning that was because that's where the berm was for that protected Mill Village, and that's been blown out by Irene.
Yep. But whereabouts on Mill Village is that?
It's just if you go to Child's Crossroad, you know that?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. You go probably 100 feet, and you go into the...
In the fields.
It's on the left.
You'll
outside.
Notice it. You can't really see it because it's overgrown right now, but
is
once the frost comes...
Yep.
Once the winter in November, you'll be able to see where it's all. You'll see where it looks like pebbles and stone and everything. It's like it's a big whooshed area.
I don't remember the name of the storm, but in 85, there was a big, there was a flood down through there.
But it held. This got blown out from Irene. And I think in that particular place, it's like 12 feet less now than it was. The 16 feet is on the other side of the river, like Savage's Field.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is the 16 feet area.
Sure.
And that goes considerably more.
So a lot of that stuff wound up down in the Sound, but I know they scraped up some of that when they were rebuilding after Irene, but they were just kind of building a small amount back, or
that's
not
a
even
further up on, off of Stillwater, I think.
That was
I do remember seeing piles and piles of stuff there.
All that piles of stuff was,
it was out in the fields there.
Yeah, that was stony.
Yeah.
Stuff.
Right.
All the really good silt topsoil ended up down at Long Island Sound.
And I see.
There's a NASA photograph that. It's all brown, and that's all Deerfield soil.
Wow.
It's unbelievable.
Great.
That's how we got $10 million worth in Long Island Sound Initiative to do repair and repair
some
work.
Repair.
But unfortunately, we're not eligible for it.
Use some of that money to put some of that dirt back in trucks and bring it back?
Can't spend it. I can't figure out how to spend it.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah. We're having a hard time spending the money. Because you got to have the way they set it up so municipalities can't use it, and you have to have some kind of agricultural connection, and you have to have a match, and you have to do all this stuff, so it's basically worthless money. I mean,
classic.
It was
from the government.
That's the government.
But it's still in China anyways.
Well, anyway, it was a lot of work, and I thought we had it, but when the rules got promulgated, because what they do is they allocate the money.
Yep.
And then the rules are promulgated, and when they promulgated the rules, they basically tied it up.
Yeah.
So it's worthless. So anyway, if it sounds like I'm crabby, it's because it was
I understand. It's a lot of work
years.
On your part.
It's been 4 years. I know.
Yep.
And we got the money, and then you can't spend it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Doug.
Upcoming events. Allow me to update that list. September 22nd, tomorrow, the Sewer Study Committee meets here at 6 p.m. I know that Kevin will not be able to attend that meeting, but he's informed the chair of that. There's a note in your packet that I would be out of the office on the 22nd and the 23rd, but I will be in the office tomorrow and Friday. There's plenty of work to do, so I'll be here, and I'll be here pretty much through the weekend. I will likely not be in the office on Monday the 26th, just so you're aware.
Okay.
The Hampshire County Select Board's Association meeting is at 5:30 p.m. At the Blue Bonnet in Northampton. That's on the 29th. And I believe Carolyn and I think you're registered for that, Carolyn, and I think Kip is registered for that as well.
No.
No?
You got us mixed up. We're doing the Franklin County.
There's a Franklin County Selectmen's Association. I believe you're all registered for that.
Okay.
When is that?
Northampton.
Okay.
The Hampshire County Select Board's Association meeting is in Northampton at the Blue Bonnet.
Okay.
And I do have registration. I think that's one of the ones that you would ask to be registered for.
Hmm. Do you know what the agenda is?
A little bit of electricity aggregation.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And that's
Cindy,
good.
You're going to go?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I can't. My anniversary.
Okay.
It's a good turkey dinner, too.
Oh, yeah. I hear you.
If you could go, I would really actually appreciate it.
Yeah. Quarterly meeting of the Select Board Association, the Franklin County Select Board Association.
Yes. Franklin County is all three of us.
Yeah, when is that?
That's in October, I believe.
Right. I don't think I've actually got a. I'll check on that.
We're supposed to be
But I'll make sure that you're all registered.
Yes, please.
For it.
And send a check out. That was what I had sent you the email on.
Then I'm fairly certain that that's all set. That's
okay.
Impressive.
Can
I'll
you
confirm,
just,
but I'll.
Yeah. Because that was the one I had sent the email for.
Yep.
Just to make sure that we got signed up and got it in the warrant.
Okay.
Okay.
Wendy Foxman will be returning to our area this coming weekend, and I will be meeting with her first thing on Tuesday morning, the 27th, not on the 26th. We will likely have a conversation about a lot of outstanding projects and start to work up a game plan for transition. And I expect that I will meet with Wendy and probably with Carolyn at some point a little bit later next week. Once Wendy and I have our feet underneath us, we'll be able to provide a transition in that way.
Great.
The Planning Board is meeting on October 3rd. I do encourage the board to attend. While you don't have a formal role in this project at the preliminary stage, you do have a role in it when it comes to definitive site plan application. So please I know you're already getting informed on the project. You've got a meeting set for October 5th. That's your next regular meeting. And I put down October 11th as a potential meeting date with Sunderland and Waitley Boards of Selectmen. That is in flux. There's a number of reasons why that date won't work, not the least of which is, I think that's Columbus Day, or is the 11th a Tuesday?
11th is a Tuesday.
Okay. I believe that that is a date that will not work for the Waitley Board.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm still trying to coordinate a date with Waitley and Sunderland Town Administrators to try to figure that out. They basically want to meet to talk about the South County EMS, I believe, and mm-hmm. the housing. They also want to have a conversation about the move of the administration building for the schools. I think, though, I don't know if it was Kip, if you and I had that conversation. You and I had the conversation.
Yeah.
Where I'm not even sure if the select boards even play a role, because
it's a town meeting kind of thing.
Well, the Frontier School Committee is the executive authority when it comes to deciding to do that, and town meetings are the appointing authority and the appropriating authority to determine whether the money can be used. So if Frontier Regional School Committee decides that it doesn't have money appropriated for that purpose, they have to put a warrant on the article of each of the four town meetings, to get money to do the work.
And they
select board, the only thing you would do is, you know, make sure it's on your warrant.
But they could still use cash reserves, right?
Yeah. Without, well, the whole I think they have they have money left over that they were going to use for renovating Christian Lane, but they want to take that money and use that money to move. And I guess when the towns appropriated the money, they appropriated it for that building. And so I think they were hoping that if we have a special town meeting or everybody puts a town meeting, to just reappropriate that money that's in there just to allow them to use it there. And then I'm not sure if they have money in E&D that they were going to use for the balance of that or find other funding. But I think they just wanted to make sure they were spending the money, was okay with all the towns when they did it.
Do you know how much money was appropriated for the repairs in Waitley?
I think there was a lot, but I think it's been spent over the years, because I think it was like 10 years ago. I think it's been a while.
Okay.
But there's money left over. I do not know how much.
So they would want to reappropriate that money.
They just want to kind of say
some money from their E&D.
Right. Can we move this instead of using it for this building? Is it okay, towns? Can we use it to move it over here?
I think I'll stand by my earlier statement.
I think everybody would say yes.
If that's what they want to do, they need to just say, here's what we'd like to do, and we need to come up with a warrant article to say that.
That's what I think. That's what I think is going to happen. I know they have a...
Yeah. Have they moved? No, they haven't.
No, they haven't. As far as I know, they haven't yet. There's another joint meeting on this, I think, in October. I want to say the 13th. Nope. The 6th. Yep, the 6th.
So are they going to let us know if we need to have a warrant article? Because, I mean,
yes.
We still don't have a date.
Correct. So I think they will.
Okay. Let us know. Are the other towns having special town meetings? Have they set special town meetings?
I don't know. I don't think so.
Okay.
Sunderland actually, I apologize. Sunderland just had a special town meeting last night.
Oh.
But there wasn't a warrant article?
No, I don't believe there was the special time. Thinking that the guys in the Access Center booth might be able to answer this a little more than I would, but the Sunderland Town Meeting, I think, had to do with the potential for a senior housing development on North Main Street.
I didn't see anything. I mean, I don't remember. Vaguely, I don't remember.
I had a special town meeting scheduled, but I don't recall for sure.
I don't either.
So, there we are.
We'll check in tomorrow.
Carol, did you happen to get the package in your thing?
Right here. I haven't had a chance to look at it. I just picked it up today.
Got one as well.
Yeah. Do you want to have him come in and speak with us at some point?
Yeah, I mean, do you want to wait till after you go to the Hampshire Selectmen's meeting? And then we can schedule a date?
Yes, that'd be fine. But I kind of think I know what's going to happen down there. That's why I really like to go.
Oh,
it's,
okay.
It's more or less going to be our presentation from the HCOG to continue on with them. But they've got a lot of issues, and I learned recently that Montague has left them and has gone with a company called Direct Energy. And I did a little research, and they're the largest aggregate supplier in the country.
So who are these guys?
This is a local company.
I'm not really even sure where they're from, but the representative.
Well, it's John. I know John.
John, from Conway. But I've spoken with him before about it.
And we've had him before. We've talked to him before. I don't know. What was it? 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah, he also went to the Franklin County Select.
Yeah, and And we ended up going back to the HCOG. But, so I didn't know if you had other, I mean, if you knew anything about the Montague people thing?
No, I just did a little research online, found out that a bit. Well, but I can reach out to them as well.
I mean, we can schedule everybody to come visit.
Okay.
I mean, I have no problem.
Yeah, okay.
Figuring out.
Well, there's.
But why don't you organize who you want us to talk to?
All right, there was also another gentleman.
Tony Hanna is the person you're thinking of, I think. He represents, I can't think of the name of the company, but he's met with representatives from the Energy Conservation Committee. And it's also an energy aggregation company, but they deal exclusively with green sources of energy, wind power and solar.
Yeah.
And he made a presentation to the Energy Committee, and they did talk about that at their recent meeting. I would just recommend reaching out to David Gilbert Keith for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know he's feeling better, I think, so we good. Should.
Yeah.
The other person I spoke with, his name was Mark Capardano, and I'm not sure what the name of his business was, but they're out near the Boston area too.
Can you get Kip David's phone number?
Yep.
So is that the people from our energy?
David Keith is our chair. And I think he's feeling better now.
Yep.
So why don't you, I mean, he's been out sick. So why don't you work with him to come up with whoever we want to meet with, whoever you want us to meet with. I'm open to anybody.
Yeah.
It
doesn't hurt to
the
listen.
Problem,
so.
Right.
The problem is it's very complicated. So it would be good to have.
I think that's what we rely on these people. You know, I don't care about all the packets. All I need is, you know, give me a figure on the bottom line. What's it going to cost? That's a pretty simple.
The problem is they all have different contracts, and a lot of times we have to go to town meeting because they want long-term contracts. We can only sign a 3-year contract without town meeting approval.
Except energy contracts are exempt.
Oh, are they?
I'm sorry. They're exempt from 30B, so you can simply choose a company, but you're absolutely right that the term of the contract over 3 years, I think, does have to go to town meeting.
I'm pretty sure
but
it
I
does.
Think it's, in my opinion, it's prudent not to get into these long-term contracts. Things change all the time, so, you know, 2 or 3
years.
Well,
but that, a lot of times, when you look at the bottom line, though, they want you to sign this giant contract, a long-term 10-year contract. And it makes me so nervous to do a 10-year contract because, like you said, things change. And it might be cheaper, but then you're going to get.
Right.
Yeah, that's one of the
5 years from
that
now,
I think
it's
you
be
might
awful.
You know, want to consider, want to keep in mind. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, that's
you also,
what we've
you
been
also
really nervous. I mean, I've been really nervous
credit,
about this kind of stuff.
Net metering credit
because it's really complicated.
Well,
but that's what you would.
Oh,
okay.
You rely on the representatives to, you know, give you, I mean, you can read through the thing, obviously, but.
That's where we re-signed up with the FERCOG, I mean, the HCOG.
One thing that we're working on is coming up with a spreadsheet so that you have a comparison to from how long you might expect to be, what your 10-year averages were, what the track record is, and what it's going to cost you. This kid was talking, what is the bottom line?
Mm.
Well, you know, though,
and
but they're not clear.
And then you look at it on a piece of paper because most of the people you're going to bring in here are salesmen.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have it all. But
well, Mark, you remember those meetings we went to?
They go on forever.
If you
have it on a spreadsheet where you can say A, B, and C company, this is a 5-year contract, guaranteed this amount of money, this is what it's going to look for, then you can at least make an educated guess as to what you want to do and where you want to be. We kept getting these things that kept sounding better and better and better. Every time we'd go there, there'd be another window washer added to the thing or something. But the David and the Energy Commission Committee were looking at trying to get a non-biased spreadsheet of these companies.
Yep.
So that basically when you walked in, you could ask them specific questions as to
what you wanted and why is their performance not what you would think it would be, and then they could explain it. And it got out of the car salesman realm into this is what's best for the town of Deerfield.
Yeah.
And that's what we have to do is get organized on.
Yep.
I would recommend that you make use of your energy committee. They've already been talking to some folks, and they would probably be the once you start talking and you start to learn the language and start to learn the terms and start to learn the various strategies, now you can start to talk to folks at their level. The energy committee is on their way. So if they conduct at least preliminary interviews with a number of different companies, build that spreadsheet, and then bring to you two or three recommendations and say, here's this company and this company and this company, and they look to be the top brands, if you will.
We don't have a lot of time, though. You know, this agreement runs out in November. So, you know, somebody's going to have to. I mean, I'll do it, but I don't mind reaching out to these, but,
right.
You know, I want to get this thing going.
Yeah, I would just suggest
they've
that
done
talk to them
already.
And see what they've done.
Okay.
And if it's something you have to take the reins on, fair enough.
Okay.
But maybe they can save some time.
Sure.
That's all.
Make sure they know the deadlines.
Yeah, that would be good, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because David has been sick.
Well, that's okay.
Did you want to talk about the search committee? We were going to appoint the search committee.
I have that as part of the report, yes.
Okay.
There's actually a number of small detail things that I apologize for throwing this at you tonight that I will wait on till later. That I will wait on for a bit. Let's start with that. I do recommend that this board formally appoint a search committee or a screening committee for the hiring process for a town administrator. By appointing this committee, you allow them to meet, but this committee can choose to meet and you can direct them to meet in executive session. That is permitted so long as there is not a quorum of the appointing body present. So
my understanding is that you volunteered?
I'd be happy to.
Okay.
I mean, if you all feel you want
yeah.
me to.
Well, yeah. I was thinking of Trevor then, mm-hmm. since you did volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
Dick, John Cordier, I did ask John Cordier already. He
Good.
Did volunteer.
Okay.
So there's Dick Kalaszewski, John Cordier. I did ask John Pachorek, and Brenda, our accountant, has been. Basically, we had mm-hmm. we've been having those four. And so by you volunteering, if that's all right with you, Kip.
I'm fine with that. I mean, I would have liked to do this, but what he just said, that if Trevor and I were there together, then it would not work so fine.
It can only be one of us.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Okay.
The expectation is that the search committee would bring no less than two applicants to this board for a public interview and yeah. consideration.
Sure.
But the idea is that it's in the by not having a quorum,
sure,
it can be an executive session.
Right.
So in case somebody doesn't want it be public that they are applying.
Correct.
I mean, if they have already
sure
like a town administrator job already.
I wanted to just provide this. This is just some information that I retrieved off of a different municipality's screening committee charge, and a lot of this made a great deal of sense. I checked this against MGL for applicability, and it does work. Scrubbing down to the action by the select board, mm-hmm. I want you to be most aware of that. Even if the screening committee comes forward to you with a couple of recommendations and you conduct your interviews, you can either choose to appoint someone or you can choose to not appoint any of the recommended candidates. You can ask that the screening committee go back and seek new candidates, or you can dissolve the committee and charge a new committee to do the work.
Okay.
And I just want to make sure that you're aware of that,
mm-hmm.
your options there. I fully expect that the screening committee will do its work very promptly and provide you with some good, solid candidates. And I am hopeful.
Okay. I'm fine with that. So you want that a formal motion? Then I make
yes,
a formal
please.
Motion to appoint Trevor, John Cordier, John Pachorek, Dick Kalaszewski, and Brenda Hill.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hear none. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Thank you.
So you'll let Wendy know who's on the committee and they can move ahead.
And I will also inform everybody in writing
Okay.
of their appointment so they're aware.
Mm-hmm.
And that Wendy would be reaching out to them. The expectation, Wendy's expectation is that she would help to coordinate the activities of the committee, but she would not be taking an active part in the deliberations. So that'll be up to the five members of the committee to do that work.
Okay.
So, a few other things on my report, if that's all right. We've already talked about the packet of information you got from Good Energy. Definitely look at that. And you discussed that, so we'll leave it at that. And I've already mentioned that the town's in receipt of a cable franchise agreement. There it is. I've received notice that MassDOT has issued information regarding the small bridge repair program. This could provide the town with a grant of up to $500,000 for the repair of a bridge of 20 feet or less. I am fairly certain, but I will ensure that Kevin is aware of this and that he can do a survey of some of the town's small bridges to see if there's any that would qualify. Broadly speaking, do we have any?
Hobby small? Road. Well, we have culverts that potentially could be considered bridges,
okay,
like Hobby Road, and there's a couple of them in town.
Okay.
But have Kevin look and see what their criteria is, because we could put, like in Mill Village, we could put another open bottom culvert that is considered a bridge, but it's not really a bridge. So just see if there's any. I mean, I was thinking of Mill Village.
That's the one we're already repairing, right?
I mean, it's a mess, and it would be, and it's going to cost a lot of money, but it would be a lot easier to put in a big wide bottom culvert instead of trying to do all this other
solve
stuff.
Solve the problem once. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So if we might be able to, just see if Kevin can squeeze us in.
Yep. Okay. I will make sure he's got that information.
And we, you know, we can get all the letters ginned up, you know, alternative emergency route, all that stuff that, you know, we can, so that we can qualify.
And the incidents of flooding that have happened there over the years because
constant,
of that.
We got constant documentation, all kinds of stuff.
Absolutely.
And we'll, we can contact Northampton DOT and tell them, you know, and coordinate the number of times that we call them.
Right.
I mean, I call that desk all the time, that on the weekends, just so it's documented. So they can just log in my calls is enough to show that there's a need. So we should, if we can squeeze somehow qualify them, we should be able to get money for that.
Okay. I'll check with Kevin tomorrow if I can to talk about that.
Speaking of, did you have a chance to look into that complaint off of North Street off of Pleasant Street?
I did not. Kevin has been made aware of it though.
Okay.
Yes, you've got that letter in your packet.
I just want to make sure we're following up on it, because it was an August letter, and I'm certainly sympathetic with her complaints, and we have been trying to sort that out, and we get working with the railroad is painful.
It's difficult. Yes.
Speaking of the railroad, you know, we talked a little bit the other night at the PTA meeting about the discussion of a fence along there.
The problem is if you a train going 90 miles an hour.
No, I'm not worried about that. I'm worried about like the kids that are playing out there. Their balls constantly go over.
Oh yeah.
And if we can minimize the noise of that train zipping by there with a fence,
you can put up noise. I mean there are
along the highway they do the staggered
yeah
things,
there is those noise fences.
But even if I could get something high enough to keep the balls in. I mean, we're so close to that track.
I know,
they constantly
it's nasty.
Are going over there. And,
I know.
You know, it's usually the trains aren't going by when the kids are out there, but who knows, you know, what changes.
Well,
but
I was just going to say that there's going to be more
is
trains.
There anybody to contact about assistance from them? No.
They're no, just, it would be our expense.
It would be our dime.
Yeah.
Are you talking about just the elementary school or also the high school?
Fence.
Have the railroad put up a fence? They
a
want.
Safety fence along the railway, or on the edge of the elementary school property.
We can't even get them to put in a decent grade, so I mean, you're not going to get a fence.
There's
but
zero help.
There's zero. The thing about it, the problem would be the fact that you get brush boats, you get that charge controlling the ground fires. Get close to the school because it gets so close into that. You need something to
stack up all those old railroad ties. Yes, but...
Go right ahead, yes, but...
Can we stack up or down?
I'll be sure to touch base with Kevin on this as well.
Well, it would just be very helpful.
Is it the kids not to walk over there, or is it to keep the...
The kids are constantly going over there to catch their balls, because our playground is on the tracks.
It'd be easier to put up a net to keep the ball from going over there?
Something like that, I guess.
Because we could put in some telephone poles and get some netting that would keep the ball from going. And if you move it during the, you know, the off-season, you can, they can brush and clean it up. There's a bunch of local people that can...
Charlie, wouldn't it make more sense if you put just a regular 4 or 5 foot fence along that end of the building, just not let kids go over there at all? Because you get that ball field and everything on the other side. There's plenty of playground. Just keep them off that whole side of the building.
It's hard to do that, I think. When I talked to administration the other night, you know, we talked at the school committee meeting and at PTA, and there's not a lot of buy-in for keeping kids out of that side of the building.
So. Until a train comes sliding through there.
No. Yeah.
Okay. So,
we'll work on it. Figure out something. Okay.
There's a number of other things in my report to you. It's fairly comprehensive. What I tried to do is outline projects that have been completed, projects that are kind of ongoing but getting there, and projects that are not started or need to be begun. I wanted to point out a couple of things that are good. The website, of course, has been completely rebuilt. We continue to welcome comments and feedback on that site to make it more usable for the town's residents, but I think we've come a long way, and I think it's actually a great site now. It's very usable, very easy to find information.
You know what? I just had complaints tonight at the Capital Improvement Committee.
About the website?
Yeah.
In regard to?
Accessing meetings, was it, Jeff?
Yeah, there is a few.
Meeting... People are still having not an easy search for meeting dates.
It's right on the calendar. When I
calendar. And the calendar actually is even something that you can subscribe to so that as soon as a new event is added, it'll automatically show up in your local calendar if you subscribe to it.
Well, what I'm going to do, Doug, is I'm going to actually use it. So if I can use it,
we're good.
Then we're good. So I'm going to go on it. Instead of using my little paper calendar, I will see if I can do it.
In all seriousness, though, I would strongly encourage anybody with comments or concerns to get in touch with us, because most of the time they can be solved very quickly.
Yeah, we want to make it better.
And we do want to make it better.
Oh, no, I agree. But Jack Davey did have, he had some issues, right, tonight?
Jack had some issues.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll do that.
Jack, if you're watching from home, give us a call tomorrow. We'll be happy to help. We are continuing to work on a draft agenda for the fall town meeting, if there is going to be one. At the very least, I want to provide you all with a list of recommended warrant articles that can go on to a town meeting whenever one happens. That'll be up to you.
John Parsky is going to give you what we voted at the CP.
Yep, the changes to the CIPC bylaw. Sure.
Yep.
That's great. Let's see. The old Deerfield Civil War Memorial is a project that's ongoing, but he's over there standing quietly.
Yes, he is.
Francis Miller from Conserve Art spent the day making the move of that monument from its temporary home at the Pecantuck Valley Memorial Association Hall to this location. They made the move today. He'll be back tomorrow to do some filling in and to stabilize it completely, and there it will stand. After that, Small Corp will be down to place the rest of the case around him. There will be plexiglass sides and another cherry-trimmed top. The top will be glass or plexiglass, so light will allow, we'll be able to still filter in from above, and so he'll stay well illuminated throughout the day. And there he'll be. So I encourage folks to come down and take a look at this 139-year-old sculpture that braved the elements for...
Why didn't it stay at the Memorial Hall?
They simply didn't have the ability to store it long-term. It was basically in their activity room, in their classroom.
So a lot of townspeople.
And a lot of townspeople want it down here. Yeah, they didn't want it. And so it's down here, and I hope Barbara will be able to sort out the voting stuff.
Yeah, work around it.
I'm fairly confident that she will, because usually when they set up for voting, she places a table at the bottom of the ramp facing this way for people to check in at. And I think there's still plenty of room in front of the case to put that table. I think we'll be okay. I do want to, since we've got the cameras and we've got the mics, I want to make mention that there are many players to make this happen. Phil Zay from the Historic Deerfield, Tim Newman and Deb Lodgett from the PBMA, Keith Finan and Catherine McKay, and many, many other members of the staff of Deerfield Academy, and of course Kevin Scarborough, Chuck Willer, and other members of the crew at the Highway Department were integral in helping to make this move and to make this happen. Casey Warren and John Nove helped to coordinate the grant writing for the grant money and the CPA application. And of course, Dan Graves and the rest of the CPC who provided the grants, who approved the project. Small Carpenter and Greenfield built the display case. And of course, Francis Miller from Conserve Art conducted the preservation effort. The preservation, oh, are those doors still open? Good. The preservation effort is incomplete, and the Historical Commission will be applying for more CPA funds in the spring to finish the stabilization and rehabilitation of the pedestal itself to make sure that that's weathertight and will continue to stand for the time being. We are this close to selling the garage building on Coates Avenue. Thayer Street Associates is working on the final draft paperwork, and I expect that you'll be receiving closing documents within 2 weeks.
Perfect.
And that will mean Thayer Street Associates can start to expand their business as they planned.
Great.
And that's terrific. There's a number of things which are undone, but I've provided some information in detail on all of that. And you stole my thunder. Yes, this is my last meeting. I would like to take this opportunity to thank people for their support. I want to thank Pat Raymer, Sarah Mission, Pat Kroll, and Priscilla Phelps, who I believe are the unsung heroes at Town Hall. They show up every day. They work diligently. They help the other folks, the higher level folks, the administrators, and the department heads to do their job. Mm-hmm. And they do tremendous work. I'd like to thank Barb Hancock, Karen Menard, Richard Kalaszewski, Chief John Pachorek, Brenda Hill, and Kevin Scarborough, who as department heads, I think, dedicate a great deal of time and energy to this town. They bring, all told together, over three-quarters of a century of collective experience to this town, three-quarters of a century of municipal experience, and Deerfield benefits from that every day. Their dedication to the town and the efforts they extend, I think, far exceeds the reimbursement they receive in their paycheck, and that should not be overlooked. You, the town is fortunate to have these individuals leading the departments, and I would encourage you, the select board, as well as other members of the town, to draw on them for their knowledge and to trust their experience, their ideas, and their creativity. And that's enough for now. The rest is there in print. I'll include that with the record of the minutes for future reference.
Thank you very much, Doug.
Thanks.
Thank you.
We need an executive session once you're done with public comment.
Okay. We'll have public comment right now before we go into executive session to talk about sale, transfer, or lease of real estate and collective bargaining. Is there any public comment? Yes.
David White from Shidwell Street. Concerning the project proposed for Shidwell Street, tonight, after listening to the board discuss it, I come away with more questions than what I saw at the planning board meeting. So my suggestion is slow down and let's resolve these issues. Study them. Kip, you came up with your water issues. It's the same issues we're facing there on Shidwell Street. You can't stop water flow. Okay? You got sewer issues, you got traffic issues, you got the question of who owns Shidwell Street and decides on the two curb cuts that are proposed. On the plan, it's 285 feet. The regulation is 600 feet. I'm told. That is a safety regulation that does not deserve a waiver.
As far as the water, we live in an old neighborhood, many of my neighbors and I. We have old foundations, stone. We do not have fancy, brand-new drainage systems to protect our foundations. Those houses were put there 100 years ago, 125 years ago, because that was dry land. If you move that water, you're going to move it from historically wetland, and I'm not talking swamp cattails, I'm talking subsurface wetland. You're going to move it into dry existing neighborhoods and damage them forever. Thank you. So.
Thank you, David.
Thank you, David. We did receive your letter.
Yes.
And
there are other issues on there, but as I said, it's just.
Well, I think we will be following up on it. It will be on the agenda for our next meeting as well, for Kip to update us on the what you know happened at the site.
30 years ago, we were told do not drink the water because it was polluted with agricultural pesticide pollutants. I'm told now that the plume is clear. It's amazing that a proposed development and the coincidence of the plume clearing. The town should study that and find out if it's locked in the sediments like it is in the Housatonic River, in the Hudson River, or if they have totally left the soils and the water. You have to study the water coming off of Mount Sugarloaf. If you look at the land above Mountain Road that was gullied all these years, there's millions of gallons of water coming down there. Last week we had two rainstorms on that land that come out to 940,000 gallons of water. That's going someplace. And that's a natural aquifer that stores that water and releases it back into the water table at a rate that allows the other neighborhoods to stay in dry cellars.
I know in one of your phone calls to me you said that the water table has changed. So you are saying that you believe the water table has changed
the
over there as
well? The water table this year is down. This is a
dry year.
1962 or 63. When I drill into the soil, I hit a ridge cap of hardened soil that sits on top of white sand at about 9.5 feet. It's all academic. I'm not equal. I have humps out in the backyard. I'm pulling water at 11.5 feet right now, so it's down about 2 feet. But the land undulates in the backyard with the ebb and flow of the water table. Now that water, we don't even know where it goes. You know, I have plumes historically in my backyard if I line the wells up that my grandfather put in that run from the mountain over towards the red roof sign, which is totally contrary to the thought that it heads right down to the water department. Okay? No one knows where that water goes. We have man-made lake, we sit on a subterranean swamp. The water entering it, like your land, Kip, you can't stop it. You're not going to stop the water coming off Mount Sugarloaf. It has to go someplace. Those poor people on Mountain Road, the design that they had was a swale to go from the corner of the mountain to behind Mal Sickie's house. That is a design for disaster. You're talking mosquitoes, you're talking water, and as you drain the water from the land, what's going to fall in behind it? Mount Sugarloaf, the gentleman that lived up there a century ago, had water on top of the mountain. He didn't have to come down. He had a spring on the mountain. That mountain is a sponge that sits there. That whole Sugarloaf range, the aquifer, all the land up North Sugarloaf, it goes someplace. Look at the drainage ditches along Eastern Avenue and Gray Street. The land is an absolute, it's a water aquifer. You're building on an aquifer. You disturb that, what are you going to gain? You're just pushing it onto your neighbors. The people are sump pumping. They sump pump, they push it over their neighbor, and the neighbor sump pumps and pushes it over the next neighbor, because you can't put the water in the sewer, correct?
No.
Now, why can't we put the water in the sewer? There was years ago a program, they were going to use the wells at 116 to try to lower the water table.
DEP regulations require stormwater to be handled not on your sewer system, separately.
Now, we have the question of the pollutants. EDBs from the fumigants that tobacco industry used for 40, 50 years here. The temic from the potatoes, and when they began the temic, they used furan. Aldecarbs and carbonates. I don't know how long they last, but materials like that can chelate in the soil, which is lock in, just like they have in, I said before, Housatonic and the Hudson River. In the driest year, these other towns aren't using their wells. What's that tell you? You've got a problem there, and you've got an old neighborhood. And I've met so many people that love that neighborhood. They love it. And we're going to destroy it forever. I'm 62 years old. I'm not going to live forever. But you put that in there, or threaten the town with a 40B project, you're going to live with that forever in this town. So I suggest you slow down and look at it. We don't even know if you can build one house on a lot or two houses on a lot. And I know the developer knows he has a problem because he's not building foundations, he's building slabs in some areas. So he recognizes a water problem. In the center of it, where they're going to put the gazebo and dual-use water retention area, they're going to use catch basins with dry wells. That was their plan. You might as well just put a pipe right to the water table, because that's where the water is going to go immediately, and it's just going to fill in. That water comes off of Mount Sugarloaf, and there's a drain between the Carol Gritz's house and the old, we call it the funeral home. Not Melsey's, the apartment that was sold. Okay. That in the wintertime freezes, and the water goes out into Sugarloaf Street. Just check your records, because you're paying people to clean it up.
I guess video of it.
You get video of it. Eric Stakarski, who owns the family homestead there, has water in his backyard, and he shows me how it goes between the two buildings across the driveway of the Gritz property to that drain. The hunters that live next, they have said about the ponds out in the back. Mal Sickie went to put a pool in, the guy suggested that he build a above ground pool because he couldn't dig a hole. He went and got Kokot's pumps and pumped the water out, and he has an in-ground swimming pool. Okay, it's a recipe for disaster. And if you put 40B in there, the people in this town are going to get up who can and leave. I'll rent my house out to a family of five, and you get three more kids in the school system, and I'll go live up in the area. But I'm historically attached to that home. That's multi-generations. I'm 92 or 93 years on Sugarloaf Street as a family. I don't want to go anywhere. So I'm willing to fight. You want to say something about using an alternative?
Well, I could make a couple statements about the proposed condo situation there. One is that because of the water problem being potentially serious, and a study probably needs to be done by some, I guess, hydrologic engineer or whatever that would be called, it also would have to be done at a time when there's actually normal water, which is not now. It might be next year. I mean, I don't think any decision on this development could be made until we have a normal climatological situation with a normal water table to make any investigations about. At the moment, it's all would just be speculation. So that would put, sort of make it clear that no immediate decision could be made until we have a normal kind of water, normal rainfall situation.
The normal water levels are restored.
Yeah, so we can at least start looking at them.
Well, our averages usually work out, so. We've had extreme drought, and there's no question about that.
And so this sort of steamroll the process of approval at this time would be kind of
I mean, we are having peer review.
I'm a bit reluctant to say anything because I don't want it to be misconstrued as I'm for something or against something. But the reality of things like this is that, you know, there are people who are very well educated on reading soils, and that even though it's a drought, they can dig a hole 12 feet deep and they can read the soil horizons and tell when the water table was at its highest. And even if we had a year where we had double the average rainfall, I'm sure if you go out to a lot of these sandy fields and you dug a hole 6 feet, you still would not find groundwater, but yet you would see in the horizon soil that at some point, and it could have been 10,000 years ago, that water level was 2 feet below the surface. And through engineering, when you're developing, say, a septic system, these people dictate as to the elevation of your septic system based on what they read in the soil, not where the actual water is. So these types of things will go on over there. You know, whether or not they find groundwater or not is not really that important with this type of study.
It's not evidence of that it has been there.
And, you know, and the same thing will hold true if you get closer to the mountain where the water leaches out of that mountain and comes down through, that will also show in that horizon. Now, I don't really know where they were planning foundations on slabs. Maybe they already discovered this, and that's why they were, you know, avoiding, you know, basements in that area. But that
what aspect does Mount Sugarloaf State Reservation have to do with this, where you're putting the product so close to it, you're putting drainage up against the mountain, so that as you drain your land, just like if you drained your land, you would draw from the mountain aquifer, you know, to the western railroad track. You're actually drawing water, I believe, from Mount Sugarloaf in a quicker fashion than is naturally occurring. That land holds. Galinsky's took a corn crop off of that lower corner this year. That's why that was such prized cropland, is because that it didn't have irrigation. It didn't need irrigation. I think the Cheswicks had one year where they finally got the rain that they needed. And once you get the rain, the land on the top holds. But that's a unique piece of property. It's going to be gone forever.
Well, there's going to be, you know, for people who think it's a done deal, that's not the case. We do have certain bylaws that we have to follow, and there are other bylaws that are quite ambiguous. And I'm going to try to address as many of those as I can going forward. Everything, you know, whether it's a traffic safety thing, these curb cuts, just so you know that the state of Massachusetts controls Sugarloaf Street.
Yes,
we can't even repair the sidewalks on Sugarloaf Street unless we get permission and a permit from the state. So they're the ones that are going to dictate, you know, curb cuts and things like that. You know, not necessarily the town.
Yeah. I asked them at DOT about it, and they were kind of wishy-washy about whether they would. They just said each case we look at individually. They don't have any real blanket rule about the 600 feet. That might be a town ordinance.
It is a town ordinance.
It is a town ordinance.
And because it's a state road, it doesn't apply.
Correct.
It's up to the state to determine what the curbs are.
You know, I mean, it...
But it is still a safety issue, though.
Yeah.
Oh, it is.
And it's in a very short distance. So, I mean, the state will determine it, whether it's safe or not. But our police chief will have input on it.
I have actually a totally wild other idea about the whole situation that has to do with like repurposing that land anyway, the 20-acre parcel at the foot of the mountain, instead of turning it into development, that the town can look at a way to preserve it as open space and use it for some other purpose, perhaps, such as, like, every time I go down Sugarloaf Street, it's quite obvious that the Sugarloaf State Reservation parking lot is pretty full most of the time and often overflowing. And there's this little ball field the town owns that's right next to
state
it. Actually, the state owns it.
State owns that?
Yeah.
Oh,
we use
the
it.
The town owned that.
No, they let us use it.
Okay.
They let us use the land for the ball field.
All right, that's, all right, that's different than what the state owns.
What he was suggesting, because we spoke about it, is using that for parking, make some type of park in the center of town, you know.
Well, like using, the DCR or whatever would be interested in making some deal with the town to use some of that 20-acre parcel for, let's say, another ball field while they take over that ball field for increased parking at the foot of the mountain and make it so that everyone gets something out of it and some of the land is protected from development, at least the stuff that's more abutting the state reservation, and maybe have a smaller area that's developed closer to the road.
But the truth of it is, the land is owned by private individuals and they have the right to sell it if they want to. Mm-hmm. If the state was interested or other people were interested, then they should get together and buy the land. These people have decided to sell it, and you know there's a process. So
my understanding was the Franklin Land Trust was trying to buy it.
Yeah, I did talk to them too. They said they had made some contact with some of the members of the family, but other members just wanted the maximum money, and that was that. But it would seem like some of them would have to step in from the outside if it's not going to be done from the inside.
Why don't you buy it?
And look into that. Yeah. But I'm just not one to like paving over farmland or arable open space.
The fact that the project does not fit in there, the water issues and the street issues, should be enough to stop it so that the sisters will have to go look for another buyer. And then the state open land, South Deerfield, or the town of Deerfield conglomerate will become attractive. Because it's not, in my opinion, and I'm not a hydrologist, that project as designed does not fit on that piece of property. You can't handle the water. It happened on Crestview. Where'd the water go on Crestview?
I would say I had significant enough phone calls to know where the water went.
There. Okay. So now you put Mountain Road between two developments. What's going to happen to those poor people?
Well,
I do know that the planning board chair expects that not in this preliminary phase, but when it comes to the definitive subdivision process, they expect to get peer consultants who are both hydrologists and hydrogeologists. They will be looking at water flows, underground water flows, water coming onto the property from outside it, water that might potentially leave the property, and then the processes by which the developer proposes to manage stormwater on the property and to make sure that it safely goes into the aquifer. And I trust that the people that will be hired as peer consultants will be able to make a good assessment and provide good information to the town so that the town can make the best decision.
What is the town regulation on runoff? Can anybody quote that as far as?
You are supposed to be able to retain water on site, including water as a receiving area.
Water should be comes onto the property from.
It is supposed to be part of the calculation as a professional water. Calculation.
And technically, water is not supposed to come onto your property. No, if water comes onto your property from another property, technically, legally, that's trespass. So if water is flowing down the side of the mountain and coming onto that property, technically, that's trespass.
So the water flows
off of a property.
I think if I went to court and asked the judge to rule against Mother Nature for that 1 million gallons, he would just look at me.
I'm not speaking about water that falls.
Well, that's what we'll say.
But if it comes down to water that is diverted, like if you have water on your property, you create a channel that put it on someone else's property.
So if that water comes across the street at 9 feet onto my property, into my cellar, that is trespassing?
No, it doesn't fall under, that doesn't apply to underground aquifers. It's a high water table.
It's
a high water table. Bottom line.
We need to go.
Yes.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. We will be discussing this further. I guarantee.
I would request an executive session.
Jeff, did you have anything?
No, all set, thank you.
Okay.
Let's just get it, Sean.
Okay. You get that.
There's an executive session, request an executive session for the sale, transfer, or lease of real estate, and for purposes of strategy related to collective bargaining.
I make that motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Daniel?
Carolyn Ness, yes.
Aye. Henry Camosa, yes.
Okay.
And we will not be coming out.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.